In this video, we're going to compute the mass of the Sun using the orbital data for Jupiter. And we're approximating the orbit of Jupiter as a circle for this problem, and we're using uniform circular motion dynamics as a first approximation for this. For those of you who know a little more astronomy, you know the orbit of Jupiter is actually elliptical, but it has a low eccentricity, which makes a uniform circular motion analysis viable. I've actually cheated a little bit here and said the average radius of the approximately circular orbit is given by this number, 778.5 times 10 to the ninth meters. That's actually the semi-major axis of the elliptical orbit, and I did that to make it so the mass of the Sun comes out really close to the correct value. So we're given that orbital radius, and we're given the orbital period for Jupiter of 11.862 years, and we're told the year is about 365.25 days. The extra quarter day there is what results in the leap year. So the first thing I'm going to do is some prep work. I want to compute that orbital period to seconds so that we're using SI units. So we start with our 11.862 years, and we start doing some unit analysis here. I have 1 year for every 365.25 days, and we'll just keep moving to smaller and smaller time units. So I have 1 day for every 24 hours, and just to make things efficient here, an hour has 60 minutes, but every minute has 60 seconds. That's a total of 3,600 seconds for every hour. And our units cancel nicely here. And I'm left with 3.743 times 10 to the 8th seconds. Now we can get into the uniform circular motion problem. And I was actually asked in this problem to provide a force diagram for Jupiter. And that's very simple. It only consists of one force, and that's the force of gravity pointing to the center of curvature here. So the Sun pulls straight to the center of curvature. This causes a centripetal acceleration, so we get a circular path for the planet. Or at least it's approximately true. Now we apply Newton's second law, F net equals ma, and the mass I'm referring to here is the mass of Jupiter, so the net force on it results in that centripetal acceleration. Well, how do I figure out the size of that gravitational force? That's where Newton's law of gravitation comes in. That's given by big G, the constant, times the product of the two masses, so the mass of the Sun and then the mass of Jupiter, which I called little m, divided by the distance between them squared, and that was called big R in my diagram. This is equal to the mass of Jupiter times its acceleration. And that's a centripetal acceleration, which we can write in terms of period as 4 pi squared times r divided by the period squared. And one of the key points here is that the mass of Jupiter cancels out. One of the cool tricks in astronomy is that anytime you observe something orbiting a much larger body, you don't even need to know the mass of the satellite body. All you have to observe is the orbital radius and the period, and you'll be able to compute the mass of that larger body at the center. So we multiply both sides by r squared, that gives us an r cubed on the right-hand side, and we divide by g, and this gives us the mass of the Sun symbolically. That's 4 pi squared r cubed divided by gt squared. Now it's just a matter of plugging in the numbers. So I get 4 pi squared, and then r was 778.5 times 10 to the 9th meters, and I need to cube that. Big G for Newton's law of gravitation, that's 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. And then our period written in seconds, 3.743 times 10 to the 8th. And don't forget to square that. And this gives me a result of 1.99 times 10 to the 30th kilograms. And to three significant digits, this agrees with the mass of the Sun posted on Wikipedia. That's a pretty good standard of excellence, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.